Now, two universities are offering free online courses to those who are looking to enhance their knowledge or those who want to return to school. Easy Lee tells us more.
So, good afternoon, ma'am. I am Mark Antonio.
Fourth-year college student Mark quickly applied upon learning that the University of the Philippines, Open University, or UPOU, is offering free short courses.
Masaya po and very excited ako. Parang grinab ko po yung opportunity since that is a program from the University of the Philippines and it's free. Ginagawa ko po yung mga activities tuwing gabi po since may klase po ako ng umaga hanggang hapon po.
According to UPOU, the number of applicants for their massive online open courses or MOOCs has increased. From 1,700 applicants in 2015, the number has increased to more than 145,000 applicants in January for their 24 free online courses this year.
Ang laki talaga ng itinaas and we are happy because ito talaga yung gusto naming mangyari. Gusto namin bigyan ng pagkakataon ang ating mga kapwa Pilipino. Nasaan man sila sa mundo or dito sa Pilipinas na nagnanais na kumuha ng mga courses na hindi nila kaya kung sila ay mga nag-work or sila ay mayroong mga disabilities or sila ay nasa ibang bansa.
Within 4 to 8 weeks, students can complete a course and receive a certificate.
Anyone can apply as much as possible. Ang ina-advocate kasi namin dito is accessible courses, more flexible courses, inclusive courses. So anybody na maiintindahan na niya yung courses at gusto niyang kunin, wala pong problema. This is all free. Walang kailang isubmit na TOR or graduate diploma or anything.
The Open University of the Polytechnic University of the Philippines offers 7 free online undergraduate programs.
Walang babayaran. So it's all free. We cater basically for the working individuals who are not able to finish college. Sabi nga namin, the undergraduate programs of the Open University is all about second chances.
PUP also recently launched their Education on Wheels, or EOW, in 2 villages in Quezon City. A bus converted into a classroom will visit depressed communities with teachers. In this program, students can pursue a 4-year degree in Bachelor of Science in Office Management for free.
Kahit sabihin natin na ang PUP ang pinakamurang tuition fee, siya rin ay libre, marami pa rin ang hindi nakaka-avail na mga bata na, at hindi nakaka-afford na pumunta talaga sa eskwelahan. Kahit pa malapit yan, halimbawa lang, dahil sa ngayon mataas na rin ang pamasahe.
Residents of Tatalon Village welcomed this opportunity since many of them had to stop studying due to life's challenges. They say projects like this give them a chance to finish their education by making lessons accessible.
Yung pamasahe, napakahirap po talaga niyan. Kahit po sabihin mo na estudyante ka, estudyante, allowance, pagkain sa araw-araw, syempre may mga projects pa din pong pinapagawa.
Po ako, wala na po akong pantusos ng pag-aaral ng tanim. So sobrang tagal na rin po noon, kaya lang matagal ko na rin pong gustong magpagpatuloy yung pag-aaral ko.
PUP plans to expand their Education on Wheels to provide more opportunities for continued education. Easily, ABS-CBN News.
Some business groups opposing moves to do away with the booklet used in monitoring discounted purchases of senior citizens and persons with disabilities. Alvin El Chico reports.
75-year-old Berna Carmelo agrees with proposals from legislators to do away with the purchase booklet for them and persons with disability to avail of the government-ordered discounts.
Pag alis mo ng bahay, pag alis mo ng lugar mo, so wala ka nang iintindihin, dadalin pa. That will be very, very good for us senior citizen. Napakagandang proposal yan.
Her favorite pharmacy had recently launched a loyalty card program, so she no longer needs to bring the booklet in purchasing prescription medicines. But a Pharmaceutical and Healthcare Association suggests using quick response or QR codes instead of booklets.
Yung ID po ng senior, pwede pong magkaroon doon ng QR code na babarili na lang sa butika. Tapos nandun na po yung impormasyon. Una, makakatulong po sa senior na makakakuha pa rin siya ng kanyang diskwento na siya yung tama, siya yung makakainom. At pangalawa po, masasatisfy niya po yung mga benepisyong.
Supermarket owners also oppose the removal of the booklet system. Senior citizens and PWDs also enjoy a 5% discount on many basic and prime commodities with weekly limit.
Kung wala na ito, magiging andito. Ibig sabihin, ang nagtitingi, hindi na niya alam kung naabot na yung nasagad na yung discount. Kung hindi, bigay siya siyempre ng bigay na discount.
I don't think that's doable kasi we gave a limit, number one. They gave a limit actually, no? The mga legislators. Number two, di tax deductible sa amin to eh. So we're shouldering it. So really open for abuse.
Meanwhile, major pharmacies had started to remove the 12% value-added tax on medicines for certain illnesses enumerated by a Bureau of Internal Revenue memo. These include drugs for cancer, diabetes, high cholesterol, and hypertension, among others. This customer says he did not know about the removal of VAT until today.
Laking tulong din kahit papaano. Kahit pamasahe, pwede na din.
After removing the VAT, a drug for cancer, which costs 415 pesos before, now retails for 370 pesos per tablet, while a brand of amlodipine for hypertension now costs 3 pesos less.
Regardless po ng edad, no, kung kahit ano po pong sa parte ng populasyon kayo, yung VAT exempt po, basta nireseta po yung gamot nyo na nasa listahan po, makikinabang po kayo dito sa VAT exemption na ito.
But for seniors and PWDs, on top of the VAT removal, they still enjoy a 20% discount for all medicines with doctor's prescription. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Social Welfare Department set to provide millions of indigent senior citizens with higher pensions. More from Jervis Manahan.
4 million senior citizens coming from poor families across the country will be receiving higher social pensions from the Department of Social Welfare and Development starting this month. From the previous 500 pesos monthly, beneficiaries will now get 1,000 pesos. This comes after the passage of a law doubling the social pension for seniors who are not receiving pension from other entities like GSIS and SSS. The agency says 49.8 billion pesos were allotted for the program, and they assure the public that only deserving beneficiaries will receive the cash aid.
May vetting process tayo from barangay, munisipyo, hanggang sa mga regional offices natin. Nang sa ganun, nato-double check natin kung talagang sila po yung mga nangangailangan natin na mga social pensioners.
On Friday, a ceremonial distribution was held in DSWD Central Office, attended by First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos.
Sa mga lolo at lola dyan, mga senior citizen, you are in good hands with DSWD.
Beneficiaries said the higher pension would go a long way, particularly for their medical expenses.
Hindi ko nga nahulugan ang isis ko eh. Apat na taon lang ang hulog ko sa isis eh. May mga anak mo ko, pero ang iba may mga pamilya na. Ninabot-abotan din ako pag humihingi po ako.
Tumatandaan ako. Yung mga anak ko naman, hindi ko sila mahingian dahil ano lang yung mga trabaho nila. Tuwing December, nagtitinda ako ng mga toys. Gamit ko yung nakukuha kong pensyon. Para naman, hindi na ako mahihiyang manghingi sa mga anak ko.
Pension distribution happens twice a year. So they were given 6,000 pesos to cover until June. At least 400,000 people are still on the wait list. But unserved seniors may get in touch with the Office of Senior Citizen Affairs in their respective villages to apply for the program. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
Here at home, oil prices are headed higher for a fifth straight week on Tuesday. Estimates show motorists would have to pay at least 1 peso and 30 centavos more for a liter of diesel next week. Gasoline may also increase by up to 80 centavos. Now, as for kerosene, prices may go up by as much as 1 peso. The Philippine Charity Sweepstakes Office welcomes a Senate probe into allegedly suspicious lotto draws. Henry Umaga Diaz tells us more.
Annie, not her real name, recently hit the 42 million peso 649 jackpot. She immediately went to the PCSO office to claim her prize. She said she's been betting on the same six numbers. But the last time she decided to change one number, and that won her the grand prize.
Paiba-iba po ako ng numero.
First time tinayaan yung numero na yun?
Mga tatlong beses, apat na beses ko pong tinayaan. Tapos nagpalit po ako ng isang number.
Last minute mo pinalitan o naisip mo lang na baka hindi swerte yung isang number na ito?
Wala, bigla ko lang po naisip na palitan. Diyos ko, magkakabahit lupa na ako. Ganun po.
Some senators, however, have become suspicious of the lotto draws after three bettors won at least 500 million pesos each in December alone. They grew even more worried after the PCSO posted on social media an edited photo of an alleged lotto winner. The PCSO explained it was meant to protect the identity of the winner. And to disprove the allegations, the agency has invited lawmakers to inspect the process. ABS-CBN went to PCSO to see how lotto winners are picked. Cases containing the draw balls are prepared and sealed in the morning of the actual draw.
Well, our cases are secured, considering na meron po siya security seal. Okay? May padlock po yan. So, iba-iba po yan. These seals are recorded from the previous use, kung kasi ginagamit nga namin on an alternate basis. So lagi ko kami may record niyan. So that's what they're doing. So isa lang po dyan ang magagamit natin for today. Yan. Kung ano po yung mapili natin mamaya. We have a judge. Meron po kami outsider panel.
Once the cases are opened, the lottery balls will be weighed to make sure that each weighs only 2.4 to 2.6 grams. The balls need to be as close in weight as possible. The air blower machines are also checked. If everything is in order, the room is sealed off. Guards see to it that nobody comes in. There are also CCTV cameras in place. Bets from lotto outlets nationwide are received by the PCSO servers in real time. Once the outlets close at 8 p.m., data from the servers are downloaded to a flash drive and sealed. The box will only be unsealed once the draw starts. The data is then uploaded into a separate computer to make sure it cannot be hacked. For Senator Rafi Tulfo, this is critical. After a PCSO employee admitted in one of the Senate hearings that numbers in the servers can be edited.
Eh, samantalang yun nandito ka last time na hearing namin, IT expert yung sabi niya, pwede. So ngayon binabago mo. Hindi pwede. Maliban lang kung magpakita sa akin ng credentials na ikaw ay IT expert.
No, Mr. Chair.
Then hindi ka pwede magsalita.
PCSO General Manager welcomes the Senate probe, but insists winning numbers cannot be manipulated.
I don't think sinabi yon. The question was pwede bang ma-hack if all the computers in the world, even Pentagon can be hacked. So it was in that context na nung tinanong siya. Of course, that's her opinion. No? Opinion yon. So I don't think you can even edit it without a trace. No? But remember, pag nabola na yan, nasa labas na yan eh.
Okay.
So, paano mo itatamper yung immediate na resulta na yun? And so po, kung nakapublish na, kung bagay. So, ang gagawin na lang dito, basahin mo na lang kung yung lumabas na combination.
Robles has sent a written invitation to senators to ask them to inspect PCSO draw facilities.
Ang sabi ko lang, I have an open invitation for them to come and visit or the representative. Please come, tingnan ninyo.
The senators have yet to respond. For now, the Senate will ask the DICT for a copy of the results of the test it conducted on the PCSO computer systems. Henry Almaga Diaz, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. distributes assistance to farmers in Pampanga during a ceremonial palay harvesting. Our correspondent Jose Carretero joins us on the line for more. Jose.
Good afternoon, Stanley. President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. led the ceremonial palay harvesting in a farm in Barangay Mandili and Candaba, Pampanga this morning. President Marcos was joined by Agriculture Secretary Francisco Chu Laurel Jr. and some local officials of Candaba, Pampanga. The ceremonial harvesting, according to President Marcos, signals the continuing progress not just in the rice sector but the entire agriculture sector. Marcos said the palay yield last year reached 20 million metric tons, which is 1.5% higher or an additional 300,000 metric tons of palay compared last year. President Marcos said the increase in yield was a result of the intervention of the government, like the distribution of high-yielding seed varieties and fertilizers to farmers. One of the programs the administration will prioritize is the construction of solar-powered irrigation facilities, according to President Marcos. This will provide a sufficient water supply to rain-fed areas, which will eventually lead in achieving the three cropping seasons target. Meanwhile, Marcos said El Nino continued to affect farmers in the country. He said the effect could worsen until June and could still be felt until the end of the year. He assured the government will help the affected sector. Meanwhile, farmer beneficiaries were thankful for the assistance they received. They were given farming equipment such as rice combined harvester, riding-type rice transplanter, and four-wheel tractor and palay seeds. More than 3,000 farmers also received financial assistance worth 5,000 pesos. Candaba, Pampanga has 19,000 hectares devoted to agriculture, according to Candaba Mayor Rene Maglanque. He said 17 hectares of the agricultural land is devoted to rice farming. He added, farmers could harvest 91 metric tons of palay during dry season. 2 hectares of agricultural areas is devoted to vegetables, according to Maglanque. With a yield of 8 metric tons a year, Candaba is known also as producer of melon and watermelon. Stanley.
All right, thank you so much for the update, Jose Carretero there. A power play that saw former Senator Leila De Lima described the recent political bickering between the so-called Uniteam coalition. De Lima says the tirades fired by the Duterte camp against President Marcos were acts of desperation amid fears of losing their grip on political power.
It's parang an act of desperation yung mga pangyayari, lalo na nung linggo, yung mga narinig natin, ang mga maarang na salita na naman. Na yung very combative na, you know, Duterte did not mince words nung kanyang speech nung linggo, ay an act of desperation na in the hope na mararally nila uli yung kanilang mga supporters both inside and outside government na para ma-prevent, lalo na yung sa ICC. Kasi dyan talaga sinakatakot si Mr. Duterte. At saka yung yung para mapalitan yung system of government na mawawala na nga sa kapangyarihan sila kasi magiging irrelevant na yung posisyon ng vice president kung sakasakali. So Marcos camp is that ayaw na nila makipag-divide ng spoils of the electoral victory in 2022.
De Lima adds the breakup between the two camps is always meant to happen.
May dalawang kampo na nakikita na nagbabakbakan, nagbe-break up na sila, nagsimula na. Yung talaga namang mangyayari yon. Although sabi nga ng iba na paaga lang. Dahil nga ito just a coalition of for convenience, kaya natural lamang na hindi talaga tatagal. Nararamdaman ng mga Duterte na naaalis na sila, na na-disenfranchise na sila sa center of power. May mga developments o may mga ginawa yung BBM administration at ginagawa ngayon sa tingin nila na lalo silang mawawala sa poder. Kasi ang patingin kasi sa sarili nila yung Duterte is since nagkaroon na ng arrangement noong 2022, nagkoalis sila para masiging malakas yung kanilang kandidatura against the VP Lenny forces, ay parang rumirenta lang sa kanila yung mga Marcos. So para, you know, yung para pag kasi susunod na nga si Sara sa 2028. Ngayon may ginagawa pangyayari na nawawala, lalo na kung mangyari nga yung shift to parliamentary system.
Another United Nations Special Rapporteur urges the Philippine government to abolish its controversial anti-insurgency task force. Irene Khan spoke to media Friday at the conclusion of her visit to the Philippines. The Special Rapporteur on Freedom and Opinion and Expression says the NTF-ELCAC should be dissolved after it linked several personalities to the armed movement. This echoes her colleague Ian Fry's call during his visit last year. Khan was in the country for 2 weeks where she spoke to activists and government officials about the country's human rights situation.
There is clear evidence that red tagging and terror tagging are being practiced by security forces as part of their counterterrorism strategy. It intimidates and chills freedom of expression. It suppresses legal activism. It isolates and antagonizes those who are unfairly attacked, puts them in a vulnerable position, and undermines public trust in civil society and the media. There is an expectation that the government will build on the steps it has already taken to make more significant legal, policy, and institutional changes. And it is only by doing that it will reaffirm the image of the Philippines as a forward-looking, vibrant democracy committed to human rights and the rule of law.
Flooding and landslides brought by heavy rains in Davao region resulted in the deaths of 12 individuals and affected nearly 300,000 others. In Davao del Norte, scores of areas still submerged in floodwaters. Our correspondent Hernel Tokmo is monitoring the situation there. He now joins us live with the latest. Hernel, over to you.
Stanley, the death toll in the recent flooding and landslides in the Davao region has risen to 12, according to the Information Office of the Davao de Oro Provincial Government. 8 people have been killed in the municipalities of New Bataan, Maragusan, Pantukan, and Moncayo, mostly due to landslides. While yesterday, rescuers have already retrieved the 4 members of a family who were buried by landslide in Barangay Gupitan in Kapalong, Davao del Norte. Many motorists were also stranded in many areas in Davao del Norte, Davao Oriental, and Davao de Oro due to landslides and flooded highways caused by low-pressure area. In Barangay Tuganay, in Carmen, Davao del Norte, the national highway turned into a parking lot after a line of cars and trucks reached over a kilometer as road became impassable. The flooded road is a way going northbound in Davao Oriental, Davao de Oro, and Caraga region. The town of Carmen is a flood-prone area because this is a catch basin, but residents and local officials say this could be the worst flooding they experienced. As many roads are inaccessible, local government units are finding a way to reach the affected areas to deliver aid. They utilize big trucks to pass through flooded roads and boats in some areas where bridges collapsed. Based on the latest data from the Office of the Civil Defense Region 11, over 72,000 families have been affected by flooding and landslides in the entire Davao region. Stanley, we are here currently in a flooded evacuation center in the municipality of Carmen, where evacuees are staying in an elevated concrete bleachers because of the flood waters. As of now, residents say that they have already received food rations, but they still appeal for more relief goods, water supply, and hygiene kits. And that's the latest here in Davao del Norte. Over to you, Stanley.
Yes, Hernel, you mentioned 12 dead already. Is that number expected to rise given that weather conditions are barely improving?
Yes, Stanley, according to the Office of Civil Defense Region 11 and even to the local officials, the flooding has not still submerged here in Davao del Norte, and there are still possible casualties and injuries that have still be recorded. Stanley?
All right, and just to give us a sense of the situation, where you are right now, you're standing in a flooded area. What sense are you getting from government? How are they calibrating the response now? Do you expect more evacuees to be housed there?
Sadly, actually, this evacuation center is flooded here in Carmen, Davao del Norte, because the floodwaters still continue to rise. Okay. Last night, we saw some pictures and videos of many evacuees packed here inside the evacuation center. But when the floodwaters increased, they transferred to other locations, and some evacuees are still staying here. That's the problem here, because before This is actually a flood-prone municipality, but this is the first time that they experience a severe flooding. Yeah. And right now, the government is looking for more areas where to temporarily evacuate the residents. And because of the many affected areas, they are still doing their best to do some relief operations. According to the residents here, they still haven't received any relief goods, only food rations. So that's, they're hoping that they will receive more relief goods and water supply here in the evacuation center. Stanley?
All right. We do look forward to more updates from you, Hernel Tokmo. Do keep safe. Thank you.